Bonsoir à tous, ravi de vous recevoir pour ce nouveau numéro des Incorrectibles. Comme vous le voyez, nous sommes dans un nouveau décor pour une émission en effet exceptionnelle puisque j'ai le grand plaisir et l'honneur de recevoir l'ancien porte-parole de Donald Trump et créateur du nouveau réseau social Gettr, réseau social qui fait beaucoup parler. Il était cette semaine à Paris et il accepte donc exceptionnellement, juste avant de repartir pour New York, de nous accorder cet entretien. Jason Miller, bonsoir. Merci beaucoup donc d'être avec nous. Je rappelle que vous êtes l'ancien porte-parole de Donald Trump et donc le créateur de Gettr. Alors première question, je le disais, vous terminez ce séjour à Paris avant de retourner à New York. Quel était précisément l'objet de votre séjour ici dans la capitale française?
Hello, je m'appelle Jason Miller. I'm the CEO of Gettr, the fastest growing social media platform in history. The first ever to 1 million, fastest ever to 2 million, fastest ever to 3 million, where we're now over 3 million users globally. We're in Paris this week, as well as Strasbourg, talking about the need for free speech, the need to be able to push back against woke culture, pushing back against cancel culture, and making sure that even as we have academia, media, statist governments, or even big tech trying to suppress our free speech rights, that we're going to be here fighting for it.
Alors, Jason Miller, avant que l'on parle plus en détail de Gettr, j'aimerais savoir qu'est-ce que la France représente à de spécial pour vous?
Eric, France has a very special place with Gettr for a number of reasons. France has given so much to the United States. France gave us the Statue of Liberty, for example. So many millions of people that are in our country. France has had such a contributing role to America's democracy. So much of independent thought and freedom of expression has come from this great country over the years. It's the least we can do to give back. Maybe it's not quite as fancy as the Statue of Liberty, but it is a pretty great social media platform. But I think also there's something special here in France with the timing of the election that's coming up this next spring for president. And as we see entering the race, there's so much anger and frustration happening with the people of France as they see the lockdowns, they see the mandates, they see the problems with the immigrants, whether they be legal or whether they be illegal. And I think that we also have a candidate that's in Eric Zemmour, who's speaking very bluntly and directly, reminds me a little bit of my former boss, but someone who's capturing the imagination of French men and women who want to see real change. So we're at this intersection where we have people wanting freedom of speech. We also have the growing digital economy, but then we also have a very charged, very exciting presidential election that brings a lot of interest to a platform like Gettr.
Alors Jason Miller, vous l'avez rappelé, donc vous avez été donc le porte-parole de Donald Trump. Vous avez dit donc qu'il vous faisait penser, en tout cas quelqu'un vous faisait penser à lui, en l'occurrence Eric Zemmour. On va en reparler un peu plus longtemps dans un instant, mais avant cela, j'aimerais que vous me parliez précisément de Gettr. Pourquoi est-ce que vous avez lancé votre propre réseau social? Quelles sont les caractéristiques de Gettr, j'ai envie de dire, par rapport à la concurrence?
Well, Eric, Gettr is the all-in-one free speech platform. It's really the first of its kind in which people are not going to be censored or shadow banned or algorithmed out of existence simply for speaking their political opinion. And so we do have a proactive and robust moderation policy. So for example, you can't post things that are illegal. You can't say that you're going to go harm somebody, for example, or dump all their personal information out on the internet. But when it comes to your political free speech rights, you're always going to have that ability here in on Gettr here in France. And that's part of the reason why I think France has done so well as far as Gettr is concerned. We have up over 250,000, over a quarter million people from France who are now on the platform. But I had a front row seat in 2020 watching the censorship of big tech and what they did to President Trump. And in 2016, President Trump snuck up on the elites, on big tech, on the media. They didn't think he was going to win, but he did. In 2020, they started changing all the rules. They started limiting what people can say. And it didn't start just with Trump, but for example, they limited what people could say about COVID. They limited people saying, well, you can't say that the virus came from a lab in Wuhan. Well, guess what? The virus did come from a lab in Wuhan. They said that you can't talk about the Hunter Biden laptop scandal. And just for the people who are watching that might not be familiar with that, that's not about Hunter's embarrassing pictures. If he wants to wear a red boa in his underwear, he can do that all day long. That's not what this is about. What this is about is the alleged self-dealing corruption that we saw about the Biden family in the business dealings that were on there, which very much reminded people of the Clintons from 4 years previous. That was suppressed by big tech, and big tech would not let people share the New York Post story that had all those details that were out there. And then, of course, we saw after January 6th, we saw President Trump completely deplatformed and kicked off of all social media. So I had a front row seat of watching all that. I knew we had to do something different. But really what spoke to me is as I started talking to my friends around the world, I realized this wasn't a uniquely American problem. This is happening everywhere. Anyone who's watching this program, for example, knows somebody who's been given a warning label on social media, who's been kicked off social media, who has a friend that's been given a warning label or kicked off. And it used to be, maybe if it was just illegal activity or something like extreme pornography or something involving children or ISIS material or something like that, where people or the big tech companies might come in and censor. But now it's even if you're expressing your political thought. I think that's dangerous.
Vous dites qu'il n'y aura pas de censure, qu'il n'y a pas de censure sur Gettr, mais quelle est pour vous la limite? Est-ce qu'on a le droit de tout dire pour vous, Jason Miller?
So, great question. We do have a Gettr Terms of Service, where we very clearly lay out what is permitted and what's not permitted. The thing that we always keep in mind is that we have this ideological North Star, this raison d'etre as far as why we're here. That is to make sure that people's political opinions will always be protected. That just because somebody says they're not popular, somebody says, well, you're not being woke enough. Somebody says, I don't like your opinion, that it's still protected here. On our platform, if you want, you could be rude, you could even be a jerk, but you can't threaten people physically. You can't use racial or religious epithets. You can't encourage people to commit self-harm. Those are things that I think are very understandably we wouldn't want to have on the platform. We want it to be safe and inviting, but at the same time, we don't want people to be censored if they dare to say something, as I said earlier, the virus came from a lab in Wuhan, or here is the COVID treatment that worked for me. Or I think that the government lockdowns or the vax passports or the vax mandates are unconstitutional, or those are against my rights or against what I want to do for my body. Or even as we talk about political issues. And let's be very blunt on this. I think many people in France right now are very concerned about the issue with migrants, about what is happening with crime in certain communities, what's happening with the lack of assimilation into French culture. As President Trump used to always refer to this friend of his, Jim, who would say, Paris isn't Paris anymore. I love Paris. I think Paris is the most beautiful city on the planet. There's no denying from when I very first came to Paris until now, Paris has changed quite a bit. And I think there's a sense of, I think people feel a lack of safety in many places of Paris. And to be honest, it's not purely just Paris. There are other places in France as well. And you know what? It's not even just France. You go to Germany, you see the same issues around Berlin. You go to Great Britain, you see the same issues around London. You go to New York City and you see certain issues. I think that every country should have a right to protect its citizens, to make sure that you have strong borders, to make sure that you're taken care of here, they're taking care of Frenchmen and French women first. And I think that's the right of every country. And I think that people should be able to express themselves and talk about some of these political issues without fear that they're going to make somebody upset and they're going to go and get their account deleted.
Alors revenons à Gettr encore, s'il vous plaît. Vous le disiez, ce réseau, donc, il a été créé il y a peu. Combien y a-t-il d'utilisateurs à ce jour? Est-ce qu'il y a des influenceurs français qui ont rejoint Gettr, par exemple?
Exactly. So right now, we're over 3 million users on Gettr overall. Here's a really cool statistic, and one that I like to share with people. Our United States user base is only about 37%. Of the global total. That means that outside of the United States is 63%. And France is one of our fastest growing countries. In particular, the last 3 or 4 weeks, we've seen exceptional growth, largely around the rise in attention to Eric Zemmour, which, by the way, you go to any bookstore. We were just at the train station earlier, and I counted 6 different magazines that had Eric Zemmour on the cover. Again, it's everybody's, there's excitement. There's a feeling in the air. People want to see what's going on. There are additional conservative publications that are online, different influencers. Papacito is one who's on, and he has a very spicy account. I hit the translate button so I can understand what exactly he's saying, but he likes to throw a lot of fire out there, so I enjoy reading or hearing him. And then as we start looking around the world, And by the way, we have over a quarter million, over 250,000 people from France that are on Getter. So that's a growing community. We have President Jair Bolsonaro, the president of Brazil, who is on Getter. We have a lot of people who don't identify necessarily as politics, because I think a lot of people just want to communicate with their friends and family. They want to connect with them. And they might not, maybe they want to express their political opinions, but they don't think about politics all the time. And so, for example, Enes Kanter Freedom, who's the center for the Boston Celtics in the professional basketball, the NBA in the U.S., he's a pretty frequent outspoken opponent of President Erdogan from Turkey and President Xi from China, especially China. He beats up on the CCP quite a bit. And by the way, the CCP does deserve to be beaten up on. They're pretty bad people. And so we have Gina Carano, the actress from The Mandalorian, Jorge Masvidal from the UFC. He's a cage fighter. So we have a lot of people that aren't necessarily politicians or politics, but they like free speech. And that is something where people are so frustrated and angry with big tech for taking away that right. With Getter, they have a place that will protect it.
Selon vous, Jason Miller, est-ce qu'il est possible de mettre fin au quasi monopole mondial qu'a Twitter?
Great question about monopolies and really what can be done about that. I think that really there are two main things that need to happen, both legislatively, respectfully, because obviously the laws in the United States are going to be different from the laws in France or, again, Germany or Spain or any other country that we're talking about. But then there's also the court system where they're going to be taking a look at some of the antitrust type provisions. I got to tell you, I'm always skeptical when we rely on government or the courts to fix one of our problems. I'm very much a free market conservative. I believe that it's best to go and get innovators and people in the out in the real world to go and try to make changes. Every time that I've wished and I've hoped for a politician or a judge to go and save the day, they never seem to save the day. I think that we a lot of times we have to do it by ourselves. So I hope that they reform things to where they make it so it's illegal to practice political discrimination from the big tech companies to their regular users. I think everybody should be treated the same. Doesn't matter if you're on the political left, if you're on the political right. Look, we have Eric Zemmour on Getter. I also want to get Emmanuel Macron. I'd love to get President Macron on the platform. I'd like to get Marine Le Pen. I'd like to Pécresse, who I know is the Republican candidate who's running. I'd like to get everybody on Getter because I want to have the full spectrum of ideas. But everybody should be treated the same. You shouldn't have one group that gets one set of privileges because maybe the owner of the platform, whether it's Twitter or Facebook or Getter for that matter, agrees with them, but then another class who doesn't have the same rights. I don't think that's fair. And also when it comes to the courts, well, the other thing I'd mention too is that big tech has a very powerful lobby. They spend a lot of money on lobbyists. They spend a lot of money on advertising, and they get their way on a lot of things because they have a lot of money to go and share around. I think that manipulates the process. And so I think with Getter, we're going to go and start making things happen.
Est-ce que selon vous, Jason Miller, si les grands réseaux sociaux comme Facebook ou Twitter continuent de pratiquer la censure, est-ce qu'ils sont voués à disparaître ou est-ce que, comme Donald Trump d'ailleurs l'envisageait à un moment donné, est-ce qu'il ne faudrait pas les combattre par la loi tout simplement?
More great questions. I do think, taking them in reverse order, I do think that we should use the law in a number of places. I'm just not particularly confident that it's going to be successful. And so while I support my former boss's legal efforts, I'm not sure that he's going to win. Number one, because there's a lot of latitude a lot of leeway that these big tech companies have for saying, well, this is our company. It's our right to say who we want on the platform and who we don't. So I don't know if ultimately President Trump is going to be successful. I think of it depending also the jurisdiction in which the case is heard will make a big difference as well. You have some areas that are conservative courts, some that are liberal courts. And so that makes an issue also. But as we talk about really how we go and change this, what we do to have something different that's going forward, I think we have to go and get more platforms. This isn't so much about, say, with the waiting for Twitter to fail or waiting for Facebook to fail. We have to go and start pulling people away and showing there's a better product. Twitter's fundamental problem is that, as the Washington Post recently pointed out, their business model really is misery. There's a reason why Twitter hasn't been as successful as Facebook or YouTube or some of the other, and because it's a negative, dark place. every morning, maybe more than every morning. I go a couple times a day to Twitter, check my account. I have a lot of followers and they're the competition. And I could say anything. I could just say that I'm having a great time in Paris. And immediately I'll have hundreds of people who comment, you're terrible, you're horrible. You know, that's the nice way. You understand what I'm saying. Just people, or if I have an opinionated take, such as maybe it's my dear old friend, Crooked Hillary Clinton. If I were to just go and say something that's more opinionated, then there'll be hundreds and hundreds of negative comments. And it's all nasty and it's personal and you get attacked from left-wing people. I like going to a place where I actually am engaging in ideas, where people actually look forward to opening up that app and seeing Getter and saying, oh, I can go and have a conversation without being attacked mercilessly. So I think Twitter's problem is that effectively they're all about misery. Facebook is boring. And I think Facebook knows that their best days are in the rearview mirror. In fact, I think it was truly unconscionable what they did with targeting the 11, 12, and 13-year-old girls with their advertising efforts. I used to be in advertising, and I'm still somewhat in advertising, but used to make television commercials. And everybody knows that people start developing their brand loyalties, whether it be to Nike or Chanel or McDonald's or any chain or any product that's out there. But people develop those brand loyalties when they're 11, 12, 13 years old. That's where, for example, when I was that age, Michael Jordan said, buy Nikes. And so guess what? To this day at 46, I still buy Nikes. Facebook and Instagram, obviously with the same owner, they knew what they were doing when they were targeting these young girls to try to get them hooked on Instagram. I think that's sick. I think that's twisted. And I think that there's a lot of backlash to that. But ultimately, Facebook is just boring. Facebook is largely where people go to talk to the relatives that you don't really want to see that often.
On voit que vous n'avez peut-être pas forcément un avis objectif sur Facebook ou sur Twitter, mais j'aimerais quand même vous demander qu'est-ce que vous pensez du nouveau patron de Twitter, Parag Agarwal, qui a remplacé Jack Dorsey et qui a tenu des propos très woke.
Well, with regard to Twitter, you know, one thing to go back to Jack Dorsey for just a moment, I actually have a lot of admiration for the fact that Jack Dorsey went and started this company and built it into a multi-billion dollar effort. And I think that he probably started off with pretty genuine intentions to go and try to talk about free speech, to spread democracy, to help connect people. But he changed over those years. And it went from helping people express themselves, to Jack Dorsey and his team telling people what they could and could not say. There's a big difference. They changed. If Jack Dorsey were to look in the mirror and see himself from what he looked like 15 years ago, he wouldn't even recognize himself. That's not just because he grew the goofy beard. That's sort of a simple fact that his opinions and his attitudes have changed. Now, with Dorsey, I think he probably stepping aside, he's just tired of the headaches. He gets attacked by everybody. Now, he brought it on to himself by starting to exercise political discrimination. But he's worth billions of dollars. He has a supermodel girlfriend. He can just go hang out and sit on the beach and have fun. So good for him. The problem is that Mr. Agarwal, the successor to Jack Dorsey, is even worse. In fact, the very first day as CEO, he said that the First Amendment, which in the U.S. is our free speech protection in our Constitution, he said that the free speech that's afforded on Twitter is not directly connected to the First Amendment, which really turned off a lot of people. They also put additional restrictions on what pictures could be shared. And now we're finding out, and this is really breaking news just within the last couple of days, and we put out a pretty sharply worded statement, that Twitter is also stopping people from talking about the COVID vaccine or talking about the realistic impacts of the COVID vaccine, even if the people happen to be right. And I'll put a specific point on this, is the fact that if you try to express the fact that people who have received the vaccine can still contract COVID, Twitter will go through and either shadow ban or delete some of that content. Well, the fact of the matter is, even if you have the vaccine, you can still contract COVID. That's not controversial. That's not picking sides in the COVID debate or in treating COVID. That's just stating scientific fact. And there's a number of people who've gotten COVID twice. People have gotten COVID after they've received the vaccine. But so Twitter, and last time I checked, Mr. Agarwal is not a virologist. He did not go to Harvard Medical School or he didn't go to study medicine at Cambridge or anything of that nature. But now he's exercising medical opinion with his platform, they've lost their way.
Jason Miller, justement, on arrive bientôt à la fin de votre séjour à Paris, avant de repartir à New York. Vous avez pu observer un petit peu les Français. Est-ce que vous voyez une différence sur la façon d'apprécier ce qu'est la liberté d'expression ou pas entre la France et les États-Unis ?
Well, every country is going to have their own interpretation of what the free speech rights and limits are. And again, some people describe it in, here are my rights to say, and other people say, well, here are your limits, what you can say. Here's what I think most people can agree on, regardless of the respective constitutions, is that usually folks' free speech rights, at least in Western countries, extend right up to the point when they start to infringe on somebody else's rights. So whether that's you're limiting someone else, or if you're threatening physical harm or things like that, everybody uses the example of you can't go into a theater and yell fire. Obviously, we don't want people to be using racial or religious epithets. We don't want people on our platform to go and put out, say, hardcore pornography, those types of things. But the one thing that I have noticed is that the same struggle that's happening right now in France is the same struggle that I'm seeing all over the world as I'm traveling around. I've seen it in Brazil. I've seen it in the US. I've seen it in London. I've seen it in Germany, that people are very concerned that their rights are being eroded right in front of them. And it starts small. It starts small. Maybe it's the culture. Maybe it's people raising the issues around being woke, or issues around political correctness, or the issues around trying to cancel certain people. It starts that, and then people start thinking, well, there's no rule against what I say, but I have to really watch what I say, and I have to kind of pretend that I'm somebody that I'm not. Then we start seeing the media start to weigh in and really reinforce many of those. And so, well, you can't be as opinionated as you used to be, because then you're going to be a bad person. Then we see governments start weighing in. In fact, when we were in Strasbourg, we saw that they were having a breakout session on inclusive speech. And I mean, literally, there are members of the European Parliament who are debating just this past week here about how we go and make speech more inclusive, which I don't know why we would have elected officials from any country that are being forced to waste their time doing things like that. I mean, just be a normal person. Don't be rude. And that's how you can be more inclusive. But then also big tech. And that's kind of the final straw now, that big tech is coming in and saying, hey, you can say this, but you can't say that. And that frustration that I see on the face of people in France, same frustration that I see back home in the United States.
Alors Jason Miller, justement, j'ai eu le plaisir de vous suivre un petit peu là au cours de cette semaine en France. J'aimerais vous poser une question qu'on ne vous a pas posée jusqu'à maintenant, à ma connaissance. Je le disais, vous êtes un ancien porte-parole de Donald Trump, mais Donald Trump a l'intention, lui aussi, de créer son réseau social, qui s'appellerait donc, à ma connaissance, Truth Social. Est-ce qu'il est complémentaire? Est-ce qu'il serait complémentaire du vôtre? Pourquoi y aurait-il deux réseaux qui aurait un petit peu la même mission?
Well, I think I use this phrase quite a bit, but two things can be true at the same time. We will be a competitor, of course. I want President Trump to do very well. I just don't want him to do too well or better than Getter. But I also think that his involvement in social media can help us, and also can help decentralize power from big tech, from social media. And just to kind of change the construct and the way that you framed it, yes, of course, we're somewhat competitors in this space when his platform gets up and gets launched. But it's not just, say, a Truth Social versus Getter. Keep in mind also that Twitter, Facebook, Instagram, TikTok, these other platforms are very much controlled by a small few collection of left of center big tech liberals who live in California, or in TikTok's case, China. We think that with President Trump getting back in, or saying that he's thinking about getting back into social media, that's going to bring a lot of people off the sidelines to get active. So here's an example. About 20, maybe 25% of President Trump's supporters stopped using social media when he was deplatformed. I know that from my own market research that I've done for Getter. Since President Trump has said that he was going to start his own platform back at the end of October, we, in that immediate 10 days afterwards, we saw about 135% increase in signups, because people were saying, well, we should get back involved in social media, but President Trump's platform isn't ready. Let's go take a look at Getter. So Getter is already, even though we've only launched on July 4th, we're only a few months old. So again, fastest ever to 1 million, fastest ever to 2 million, fastest ever to 3 million. we're not slowing down. We're going to launch our own competitor to both Instagram Reels and TikTok right around February 1st. So even before President Trump launches his platform, we're going to become a marketplace competitor to both Instagram and TikTok in addition to Twitter and Facebook. And then here's the big thing. As we talk about next 4th of July, our 1 year anniversary, we're going to launch Getter Pay, which is going to be we're going to combine cryptocurrency as well as blockchain, have a two coin ecosystem with both a stable coin and a fluctuating coin, have peer-to-peer lending, have marketplace transactions, make it so people can actually make money from their social media. So we're going to have the freedom of speech as far as with the regular Getter posts, freedom of expression, when we have what we call G-Vision, our competitor to Instagram and TikTok, and then Getter Pay with the freedom to control your financial destiny. First time ever someone's combined both social media and both the cryptocurrency and blockchain. And so we're taking off. We're going such cool places. I have a really big vision for what this company can become. And so I think what President Trump wants to do when he jumps in is go a little bit more, have the social media, but do a lot more original entertainment programming. So I think they'll, a year from now, look like two very different companies. But for right now, love to have the competition. And I would not even rule it out that he might join the platform. Join Getter at some point, because again, if he goes to run in 2024, which I know I'm jumping ahead, which I do think that he will, he's going to want to be able to talk to as many people as possible.
Alors justement, Jason Miller, parlons-en un petit peu plus en détail maintenant de Donald Trump. Donc on va peut-être le voir arriver sur Getter, mais est-ce qu'on va peut-être le voir revenir un jour sur la scène nationale américaine? Est-ce que vous pensez qu'il va être de nouveau candidat en 2024?
So I do think that President Trump runs again in 2024. And even in the most recent polling in America, it shows President Trump leading Joe Biden pretty handily. But I don't think that President Trump will be running against Joe Biden if he runs. So people in France understand all the polling shows that President Trump is ahead of the next closest Republican by 58 points. So it's nobody's even close. No one's even anywhere. So President Trump will be the Republican nominee if he wants to run. I don't even know if Joe Biden finishes out his entire 4 years. He does not look good. He does not sound good. He doesn't seem that he's mentally all there. Keep in mind that if he stays around to the end of the 4 years, he'd be 82 at that point. I think that in his poll numbers right now, Joe Biden is, his poll numbers are so bad, they're literally the lowest ever in U.S. history for a president at this point. And Kamala Harris, the vice president, her poll numbers are even worse. So I think that Democrats will look to someone else, maybe a California governor, Gavin Newsom. I know the person who wants to come back, which would be Crooked Hillary. I would love it if it could be Donald Trump against Crooked Hillary round two in 2024. I don't think I'm going to get that lucky. That would be President Trump versus Crooked Hillary in 2024 would be probably the only thing that would say, hey, Getter, I need to take a little time out to go back and be President Trump's spokesman again. I think that would be that'd be kind of the King Kong versus Godzilla type SmackDown campaign. But I think it's probably President Trump against maybe Gavin Newsom.
Jason Miller, je le disais tout à l'heure en introduction, vous avez été porte-parole de Donald Trump et vous deviez être son directeur de la communication à la Maison-Blanche. Finalement, au dernier moment, vous avez refusé. Est-ce que, honnêtement, avec le recul, vous ne regrettez pas de ne pas avoir accepté d'être directeur de la communication de Donald Trump à la Maison-Blanche?
Oh, you can always look at life and regret certain things. And so people know I was President Trump's lead spokesperson in the 2016 campaign. I was offered the job as the communications director in the White House, but I had an affair with another woman that wasn't my wife. And so we had my son. I think in France, my poll numbers would go up. In the U.S., my poll numbers went down. So I did not follow President Trump going into the White House. But I stayed a very close ally to President Trump and stayed very active with him. I was a contributor on CNN, which is the more liberal news network. I think people, you might know them as fake news. CNN is what many people call them. And so I would be the one Trump supporter that was on there fighting and defending him. So I stayed very close with President Trump. And then he asked me to come back for 2020 in a more senior level than I was even at in the first campaign. But I do think about that decision all the time. And I'll tell you why. I think that in the early days of the Trump administration, there was a lot of chaos. And I think President Trump brought in a lot of people who, quite frankly, weren't necessarily that strong supporters of his. Maybe they wanted to work at the White House. Maybe they'd worked for President Bush or different people, but they didn't really have President Trump's best interests, or they didn't believe kind of in his vision. I think I could have been a steady hand in that. And so I think back about just the, especially with the attacks from Mueller and the Russia witch hunt and all those different types of things. I think I could have been someone who really helped at that time. Fortunately, I did have the opportunity to come back and help President Trump in 2020. But I look back, but life, you can, everybody can spend all day looking, saying, I wish I'd done this, or I'd wish I'd done that. C'est la vie. That's life. If you spend all of your time looking in the rear view mirror and regretting previous decisions, then your life will be miserable. You have to look to the future and be optimistic about what you can do. If President Trump wins in 2024, maybe I'll say yes, but then follow through with it next time and go to the White House with him. We'll see.
On voit donc, Jason Miller, que vous soutiendrez Trump, c'est évident s'il est nouveau candidat en 2024. Vous avez donc des rapports réguliers encore avec lui. Dans quel état d'esprit il est aujourd'hui à l'heure où nous parlons?
So I still remain in pretty close contact with President Trump. I probably call him maybe once a week, maybe once every other week. And we still have a very good relationship. I think there's, so people understand, on the 2016 campaign, I would start every day by calling him at 6:30 in the morning. So 6:30 a.m. And when I would call him at 6:30 a.m., we would walk through the New York Times, the Wall Street Journal, the New York Post, the Washington Post, USA Today. We would also talk about the first 30 minutes of Fox News, the first 30 minutes of fake news CNN, the first 30 minutes of MSNBC. Somehow, by 6:30 a.m., Donald Trump would have read all of those newspapers. He would have watched all three at the same time. I don't know how he does it. He must have some kind of magical TV setup where he can watch multiple at one time and just absorb it all. And then he would pepper me with questions as we'd go through, here's what you could get asked today. Here's what we're going to do on the campaign trail. What's our strategy? So I got a sense to really understand him, not just from, say, a spokesman. I mean, a lot of times a spokesman for something can mean different things to different people. Because I always viewed my job not to go and try to put words in his mouth. You go and try to put words in Donald Trump's mouth and he'll be like, you know, get out of here. You know, you're a loser. But my job was to go and talk about how I can amplify his voice. That's really how I viewed my mission. Now, yes, of course, sometimes I do things like, you know, write tweets or write statements or things like that. But it was essentially echoing what he wanted to say, or I'd have a way of helping him come up with, say, maybe a smarter or more strategic way to accomplish the objective that he's trying to do. Then in 2020, we would do the same thing, although we moved the call back. Usually our calls were more like 7:30. He slept in a little bit more once he was president. But I had the chance to spend, you know, upwards of half hour, 30 minutes, almost every morning, just talking through and getting to know him as a person. And so even if we necessarily haven't seen each other for a little bit of time, I think there's a sense of familiarity. I think there's a sense of comfort, not just in the fact that that we're personable with each other and we get along, but he knows that I understand his thinking. It's anyone can go and figure out what, say, their former boss, current or former boss, what their policy positions are, but understand the way that they think, what makes them tick, what's important to them, what their real purpose is, how they're trying to change people's lives. And I think he knows that I'm genuine and sincere when it comes to that. And also, too, I think he likes to give me he's someone who likes to give people a hard time or poke fun at him or kind of joke back and forth. And so we have pretty lively banter.
Alors, est-ce depuis la présidence de Donald Trump? En tout cas, beaucoup de personnes en France disent que la politique française s'américanise. On est à quelques mois de l'élection présidentielle française. Il y a de plus en plus de rumeurs, de couverture people qui bruissent, en tout cas dans les coulisses, sur les différents candidats. D'abord, première question. Vous en parliez tout à l'heure, on a l'impression que vous connaissez assez bien, ou est-ce peut-être parce que vos équipes vous ont briefé là-dessus cette semaine. Est-ce que vous suivez la politique française, Jason Miller?
Well, I'm definitely interested in French politics, although I will not pretend to be an expert in French politics by any stretch. But with a presidential race that is coming up, I think the entire world's going to be watching. Here's why. I think for many in the global elite, the people who did not like populists, I think they saw 2020 as a massive victory in beating President Trump. And they see these elections in 2022. And again, I'm talking about the people who are more of the globalist when it comes to finances and things of that nature. They want to see Emmanuel Macron win. They do not want to see a conservative candidate have a chance against him. They definitely want to see Viktor Orban lose in Hungary. They definitely want to see Jair Bolsonaro lose in Brazil. And I think they're going to do everything they can to change the rules, to make it tougher, to try to hurt whoever the populist candidate is in any of those countries. That's the one thing that I'm not sure people realize, why France is going to be so important in 2022. The entire world is watching. This isn't just about France. This isn't just about the EU. It's not even just about all of Europe. This is globally. People will be watching France to say what's going to happen. What are the moods? Can an Eric Zemmour capture the spirit and the attention of enough people in France to go and win the race? Can someone like Macron hold on to a victory? People are going to be watching this all around the world. And so from that aspect, of course, I watch it. Again, I will not pretend to be an expert when it comes to France. I mean, as far as the media coverage, in a sense, I would almost say that might be more of a reflection of the media. And it's everything now is digital. Everything is online. Everything's about getting clicks. And you know this as someone who likes to throw out the fire and be very fiery. It's boring is worse than death when it comes to news journalism these days. And if you can't go and provide that spark or that inflammatory headline, then people will just go on to another product or another news source. So that's where you see even the what we'd call the mainstream publications now seem to be much more tabloid because it's all about the clicks. Can you get someone to click on that story, to click on that video? And if you can't do that, then you're going to go away.
Justement, vous parlez beaucoup d'Éric Zemmour, Jason Miller. Donc, j'aimerais savoir, c'est votre favori pour la prochaine élection présidentielle française. Est-ce que vous l'avez rencontré? Est-ce que vous avez rencontré peut-être des candidats pendant cette semaine que vous avez passée à Paris?
So I've, again, being the CEO of the company and especially being American, last thing I'm going to do is come in and start picking favorites within a race. But the one thing that I do know is talent and ability in communicating one's voice, having especially worked for someone like President Trump. And I see that Eric Zemmour is very much a brilliant and talented communicator. And from that aspect, I have a lot of respect for him. I have not taken sides. I have not endorsed in the race. I'll leave that up to the people of France. Don't need an American coming in telling people who to vote for. I know that's that always drives people crazy when they go and say that. I have had the chance to meet him. We spent a little bit of time together when I was in town a couple of months ago, had a very friendly conversation. I have not spoken with him since. I have not had the opportunity to meet any of the other candidates, although I've tried to. And again, I'd like to get everybody on the platform. I want to get Marine Le Pen on. I think she has a very formidable career. I think she has someone who's been in government and politics for many years, obviously running against Macron a few years ago. Obviously went to the second round. I'd love to get her on Getter. Like I said, I'd love to get Macron on Getter. Now, I've not requested the meeting yet to go see President Macron. I imagine he's probably a little busy. I probably wouldn't make the time to sit down with me, but we'd love to have him on the platform. I think that if it were smart, with Getter growing so fast and with Getter being a platform that people know doesn't cancel or censor you because of your political opinions, it would be wise for any French politician, even not even running for president, to jump on Getter. You're going to meet a lot of new people, not just in France, but around the world.
Alors justement, Jason Miller, en effet, je vais poser la question peut-être différemment. Si vous n'allez pas vers les candidats, mais que demain, un candidat vous appelait pour vous demander des conseils, quel serait le conseil que vous donneriez à un candidat à la présidentielle française? On le voit, c'est sur les réseaux sociaux pour beaucoup que l'opinion se fait. Quel serait le conseil que vous donneriez?
Ah, that's why you're the journalist. You're good. You ask the good questions. I would tell them the same thing that I would tell to any candidate, whether it be in France or in the United States or anywhere else, and say, number one, take advantage of building up your platform, building up your ability to communicate with voters going around the mainstream media. Because here's the thing that you can't happen. You can't allow the big tech companies to come along and deplatform you, to chop your legs out from under you. And I think that any candidate, again, they can be on the left, they can be center, they can be on the right. You should have different means of communicating with your voters or your prospective voters to make sure that that you always have that independence to go and talk to them, because you can't count on the mainstream media to stay independent, to stay neutral. So first thing I would say is make sure that you diversify the way that you can communicate and talk with people. The second thing that I would tell anyone, quite frankly, if they came to me, is to not sound like a politician. I think people are frustrated. I think they're angry. And again, this isn't specific to France. This is global. It's in the United States. A lot of promises have been made in recent campaigns, and many issues have gotten worse. Take a look in the United States, for example, with Joe Biden, who obviously I'm not a Joe Biden fan. I just did a campaign against him. Sleepy Joe, as President Trump would always call him. President Trump said that we'd have a crisis on our southern border. Well, we did. He said we'd have the economy going downhill, which it has. President Trump said that China would be out of control with their aggression under a Joe Biden presidency. That's true. And then the way that Joe Biden handled the Afghanistan withdrawal, I think, has been just an embarrassment, not just to our country, but everyone who spent the last two decades sending troops and spending money in Afghanistan. I think the way he did that was terrible. But I would tell people to speak direct, be honest with voters, talk right to them. Do not sound like a politician. Sound like someone who wears your convictions on your sleeve. And so those would really be the two main things. Diversify the way that you're able to communicate with your voters, and then speak from the heart and speak directly to people, and don't try to be filtered by a bunch of advisors who tell you to say it this way or say it that way. Go be yourself, but be crisp and be right to the point.
Beaucoup de gens disent aussi que le clivage droite-gauche en France n'existe plus. On parle de mondialistes versus des souverainistes. Comment est-ce que vous voyez les choses aux États-Unis? Est-ce que le clivage démocrate-républicain subit aussi la même crise?
That's a really smart and insightful question. I think that's something that we're seeing all over the world. It's definitely something that we see in Brazil with President Bolsonaro changing the dynamics of who's with what party. In fact, President Bolsonaro, I believe, hasn't even picked which party that he will be for 2022. And so it's definitely about him. President Trump ran as a Republican, but he has his own identity. People really viewed him differently. In fact, I've frequently said that if President Trump, if people viewed him as being a Republican, a traditional Republican politician, he would not have won Wisconsin, Michigan, Pennsylvania in that first campaign. I think a lot of voters were willing to give him a chance because they didn't view him as a politician. I think even you take a look in the UK following the Brexit vote, how the division between Tory and Labour have really changed into where now many more of the working people are with the Tories. And so that a lot of the rural folks, even going further north, are now voting Tory where they never used to. They used to always be Labour pretty exclusively. I think, as I'm, again, looking at this from the outside, I'm not the campaign strategist in France, but what Trump was, if I'm doing a little bit of an analogy here, what President Trump was able to do were to get people who didn't traditionally show up to vote, didn't people who weren't necessarily saying that they're a member of a certain party, but people who saw somebody who was going to be bold and declarative in their actions and talked about issues that maybe weren't very popular. President Trump said, build the wall. Very simple, very direct. You knew what that meant. That meant he was going to deal with immigration. He was going to deal with crime. And people who weren't active in politics then came to him and they showed up. And that's why they call them Trump voters, because they only show up when he's on the ballot. I think that whoever comes out of the first round of the voting here, if they're able to speak and ultimately then being the challenger to Macron for the second round, if they're able to excite voters in the same way, and whether it be a Zemmour voter, whether it's a Le Pen voter, somebody who is able to pull in people that don't normally line up with a particular party or vote less frequently, I think there's a real chance to make that a competitive contest against Macron.
Jason Miller, le slogan de Donald Trump, c'était « Make America Great Again », on s'en souvient à tous. Alors, première question, est-ce que vous aviez été consulté pour le choix de ce slogan? Et deuxième question, est-ce que vous considérez qu'avec l'élection de Joe Biden, aujourd'hui, c'est plutôt « Make America Down Again »
So President Trump did not need me to chime in on that particular slogan. In fact, I think he had even trademarked it, I think, well before even that campaign got going. I think I'm right when I say that. But Make America Great Again, easily the best slogan in political history. I just can't think of another slogan that it just, when you say MAGA or Make America Great Again, people know exactly what that is. They know that it's, or the America First agenda. People know, okay, they probably stand this way on the issues. This is probably the type of cars they buy, the restaurants they go to, the news that they watch, the way that they have fun and interact with people, maybe even what sports teams they like. One of the greatest slogans, but it spoke to something. And I think that what it kind of the throwback to it is people wanted to feel proud again. And I see this as I go all around the world, where people want to be enthusiastic about their own country. People in France, they're passionate about France. They say, why can't we have the good things? Why can't we have safe streets and secure borders? Why can't we have this? People in Germany say similar things. People in London, we say how frustrated they're getting with these, with the new vax passport that Boris Johnson is trying to push through. People want to have pride in their respective countries. And I think that anyone who can speak to that, restoring that pride, but then also how they're going to change it, I think we'll have a powerful message going into next year's election.
Jason Miller, aujourd'hui, vous êtes à la tête de Gaiter. Vous le disiez tout à l'heure, vous parlez à Donald Trump au moins une fois par semaine. Si demain, donc, il revenait au pouvoir et qu'il vous demandait de revenir auprès de lui, vous accepteriez? Et à quel poste?
So I'll tell you a funny story on this. So after I launched Gaiter, maybe it was about 2 months after I launched it. And obviously, I still talk with President Trump from pretty regularly. And he called up and he goes, hey, Jace. And he calls me Jace, short for Jason, which I'd never had that nickname before. But he can. It's a better nickname. He could, you know, I don't want a nickname like Crooked Hillary. So Jace is better than Crooked Hillary. But he goes, Jace, he's like, are you enjoying what you're doing? I'm like, yes. And he's like, but I mean, are you waking up every day just really excited about what you're, because you're doing something different now. You're running this social media company and this global thing. And, you know, like when we were together, we were a team and, we're having fun and things like, are you having fun? And I just started laughing. I go, Mr. President, I go, you never asked me questions like this when I worked for you. And I said, look, you don't have to say anything else, sir. I go, if you run for president, of course, I'm going to be there to help you. I go, now, I'm not going to go and drop what I'm doing with Gaiter. I'm to go and grow this company. I think it has potential, especially as we start adding in G-Vision, our short video series, as we get to Gaiter Pay, working in crypto and blockchain, and make this something. I was like, I'm doing such cool things with this. We're going to make this a global platform. So maybe I can't do 18 hours a day for you, but I go, of course, I'm going to be by your side to help out. So I think that's also, quite frankly, I think part of the difference between maybe myself and a Jack Dorsey or Mark Zuckerberg. But besides the fact that they're billionaires and I'm not, that they have their own private jets, I think that I wear my political beliefs on my sleeve. I'll tell you, if you ask me, like you said about President Trump, I'll tell you, of course, I like President Trump. I'm not going to try to pretend that I'm right down the middle or that I don't have opinions or there's not something about a candidate that I'm not attracted to. But the difference is when it comes to the social media platform, I want everybody. I'm also a businessman. I want Emmanuel Macron. I want Marine Le Pen. I want Pécresse on the platform. Eric Zemmour is already on there, and I think he's doing really well with it. I could just make a prediction that I think that whoever ultimately wins the race for president in France will be a Gaiter user.
Il y a un instant, vous le disiez, vous êtes aussi un businessman. Est-ce qu'on peut savoir qui vous soutient? Est-ce que les gens le disent facilement, qu'ils vous soutiennent? Vous avez des associés. Qui est derrière Jason Miller?
Yeah, a little bit. And since we're still privately held, we're not a publicly traded company yet, although maybe in the next 24 to 36 months, that might change a little bit. But we have a number of international investment funds that currently are funding us. There's a lot of opportunity, a lot of money to be made in social media, where we're going with the payment platform and becoming more of a financial services type company. But you also have to spend a lot of money to get there. And that's something that as we start looking ahead, that fortunately our funders have said that have given us essentially a lot of leeway to go and start building up the base and start getting things ready. But as we start moving into the first quarter of 2022, the finances aspect, as we add in the appreciation online tipping. So content creators such as yourself will be able to receive micro tips or money if people like what they see on the show. But say, hey, I want to go and give Eric €5 or €10, or maybe it's not just one time. Maybe they want to come back and do it on a subscription. Maybe it's €9 a month or something of that nature. You'll have that ability to monetize on the Getter platform. Also, is we'll have a merchandise store, but then we'll start working at things such as advertising, other revenue generators, before we get to Getter Pay, which will be really when this thing takes off in a big way. So that's kind of the structure and the format. And fortunately, our investors know, it'll take a little bit of time to get there, but it's going to be worth it.
On va arriver au terme de cet entretien. Jason Miller, il y a un petit moment, justement, vous nous disiez que Donald Trump vous demandait si vous étiez heureux dans ce que vous faites aujourd'hui. J'aurais pu vous suggérer de lui répondre. Et toi, Donald, qu'est-ce qu'aujourd'hui Donald fait au quotidien? Est-ce qu'il est heureux en ce moment? Ou est-ce qu'il est vraiment dans l'espoir d'être élu et il se projette vraiment dans les prochaines années?
So a lot to unpack in that question. I would say that his mood, I think in many ways, what President Trump did not expect is that when he got into politics, literally from the first day that he came down the escalator, that he was going to be attacked in such a vicious way. And obviously we had the Russia hoax, the Mueller witch hunt that literally took up, the first two and a half years of the Trump presidency. And President Trump really had two jobs when he was in office. One was, yes, to go and do the business of the people and leading the country, but it was a full-time job just to defend himself against the attacks. Even after he left office, they were still trying to impeach him. I led his second impeachment defense. He's out of office. He is not there anymore. They're still trying to impeach him to remove him from office after he's left. That is how nuts and insane the Democratic Party and how obsessed they are with President Trump. And as we look through where President Trump now continues to see additional persecution, you see, again, he's out of office. He's been out of the office almost a year. He's being attacked by the New York City District Attorney, the Attorney General of the State of New York, the January 6th Commission, where there, again, everything that's being done is to try to stop him from running again. I think that has to weigh on you. I usually don't have the emotion-filled conversations with the president. We don't, when we talk, we don't say, hey, how are you feeling today? That's just not really the way that he talks. And even though I might be a CEO, I'm not a billionaire like he is. So I'm not at a peer level. So I don't say like, hey, pal, how are you doing? So we don't really have kind of the emotional feelings things. But I can tell when something weighs on him a little bit. But I think part of his superpower, so to speak, is the fact that nothing seems to slow this guy down. He's like the Terminator, and he just keeps going and going. And so when I talk to him, and I kind of sometimes I pry and try to get a sense of, you know, what he's feeling or kind of where things are, but not asking directly. And he'll just go right to, he's like, say things like, Joe Biden's really messing up this country. If I don't step in and save it, I don't know who's going to do it. We have to have someone who can go toe-to-toe with this guy and against big tech and the media. And I'm really worried that everything we went and built up over the 4 years that we were there is going to get removed. And he goes, look, I have plenty of money. I have a great life. I have a great wife. Obviously, Melania Trump is very special. He goes, I have a great family. He's like, you know what? I'm at the point of life where I'm really thinking about what this country is going to look like. And if I'm going to help put us on a better path, or if it could go off the edge of a cliff, as we see with Joe Biden doing. Now, that being said, it's not bad being able to live essentially at your golf course. So whether it's in Florida or whether it's in New Jersey, I think he probably gets out and plays golf most mornings. And I've seen that he plays very fast. I'm not a golfer, but he gets out there and whack, 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 and he moves fast, and he can hit the ball pretty dang far. His putting game is really good as well. So I think the golf course is always kind of his zen place. It doesn't matter what curveball life throws at Donald Trump, he doesn't stop marching.
Jason Miller, avant l'élection présidentielle française, beaucoup rappellent que Donald Trump a été une sorte d'espoir, justement, avec cette élection dont on se souvient tous. Est-ce que vous pensez qu'on peut aujourd'hui tenir ce même type de discours, cette forme de radicalité, en France notamment, et accéder au pouvoir ?
You know, a fascinating question. And the reason saying that, and again, remind you that I'm not the expert in French politics, but I can talk a little bit more globally in what I've seen. That what people are looking for right now, and I can say this, just what I've seen from market research and polling data and such, is that people want someone who's going to go and fix the problems that are out there. People are sick and tired of the status quo politicians who say, well, we'll come up with one or two new plans, and they don't have any confidence that they'll actually go and change anything. People are sick and tired of being lied to. They're sick and tired of being sold a false bill of goods or false promises or false hope. There's a difference in that where one person might say, for example, let's take President Trump, where he had a whole host of people who said, well, President Trump is too abrasive. He's not nice enough. He's mean to migrants. But then here's the fascinating thing. President Trump actually got a record-setting level of Hispanic American voters. He got a record-setting level of African American voters. Record-setting level with Asian American voters. President Trump, for being as supposedly mean and rude as he is, did the best with minority voters of any Republican going in the United States running for president going back to 1972. So you might say, well, wait a minute. The media told us that he was terrible. The media told us that he was a racist. They said that he wasn't inclusive enough, that he wasn't he wouldn't represent the country well. But yet the very people who are supposedly the ones being told that they wouldn't like him, liked him even more. Why? Because he didn't talk like a politician. He put a focus on safety. He put a focus on the economy. And I think there's a lot of lessons to learn from that. I think that many journalists, many of the mainstream journalists, who, especially the ones who become particularly woke, they don't know anything about minority cultures. They don't know what's actually driving people. Here's one of the other things, too, keep in mind. Many people who, for example, say immigrate to a country, particularly if they immigrate to the U.S. or even immigrate to France or other places, it's not just about economics. It's also about safety. That's one of the mistakes that Democrats made is Democrats embrace the Black Lives Matter movement, which is the very essence of woke culture. And by doing that, they turned off all the Hispanic Americans who are very concerned about security. So I think that as people talk about a security message, an economic message, you have to remember that if they're talking direct to people, that there's a good chance that they can go and get additional voters to their side. So just because the media might say that somebody is too incendiary or that they're too fiery or too hot or whatever the case, that doesn't necessarily mean that's how the voters view it. Voters want action, action, action. And if you're not going to deliver, then they might vote for somebody else.
Jason Miller, on arrive donc au terme de cet entretien. Un grand, grand merci d'avoir accepté cet entretien. Dernière question quand même, avant que vous ne repartiez de Paris et donc vous ne retourniez à New York. Après une semaine ici en France, à Paris, si vous deviez rapporter qu'un seul souvenir, une anecdote, ce serait quoi?
Another great question. I think there would be a couple of them. One, when I had the opportunity to speak to some of the conservative members at the EU in Strasbourg. And I saw the look on the faces of all these patriots. We had people from MPs from 10 different countries that showed up to hear me speak about free speech and big tech. And to me, to have people from 10 different countries show up to hear me, what I had to say about big tech, I was very honored to have that. And I think that it's good to see that there are people all around the world that are concerned about the erosion of our free speech rights, who realize that what's happening with big tech, what's happening with big government, what's happening with big media is not a sustainable course, that we are this close to losing all of our precious liberties, that we have to have additional social media platforms, different ways to communicate, which is something obviously we're trying to do with Getter, our free speech platform. I would say that's one of the big things. The other thing I would say is that if you go to a cafe in Paris and you're ordering yourself some dinner and you've only had 2 years of high school French, like myself, do not try to pronounce it Jacques Daniels. Otherwise, the waiter might threaten to slap you. That would be the only other reminder that I would tell people. Just it's Jack Daniels anywhere you go. So I will always keep that close to my heart.
Eh bien, ce sera le mot de la fin. Merci beaucoup, Jason Miller, d'avoir été notre invité exceptionnel, je le disais, dans Les Incorrectibles cette semaine. Alors, évidemment, on vous souhaite tout le meilleur pour Getter. D'ailleurs, on encourage les gens qui nous regardent à s'inscrire, hein, puisque le site est dorénavant online, hein, comme on dit. Merci donc beaucoup d'avoir accepté cette invitation juste avant de repartir à New York. Merci beaucoup aussi à Lister Rivière qui m'a permis d'organiser cette émission, à l'hôtel Bachemont qui nous a accueillis aussi pour réaliser cette interview. Et puis, si vous avez, je le dis chaque semaine, aimé cette interview, n'hésitez pas à vous abonner à cette chaîne, à mettre des pouces levés et si vous le pouvez, eh bien aussi à nous aider via le lien Tipeee juste sous cette vidéo. Quant à moi, je vous souhaite comme chaque dimanche une très bonne semaine. On se retrouve la semaine prochaine et comme je le dis à chaque fois, restez incorrectibles.